All right, this question comes from a Gold Club member, Soren. And Soren writes, "Hi, Worth. I really find your lessons to be very useful and easy to understand, and it gives me confidence, being aware, when I work with computers. Actually, I wanted to understand how the software and hardware communicate with each other. Say, for example, what happens when a software program is executed? I'm not clear of certain things, like how it is executed, and terms like executable file, interpreter, client server, web server communication, etc. I understand that these are different topics altogether, and you must be having a busy schedule, but just wondering if you could help us understand these aspects of the things as well. By the way, I'm a recently joined member, and I'm really looking forward to your first set of CDs this month. Thanks, Soren." Well, Soren, first off, welcome to the Gold Club. I think I've already said this to you via email, but welcome again. And glad to answer your questions. So I think what I'll do is, you are covering a few things here with your questions, so I'm probably going to split it up into a couple of different tracks and a couple of different questions and answers. So what I'll probably do is reiterate on the next question track on the CD. I will I'll sort of reiterate your question or summarize it and answer the sort of second half of it. I see there's basically two big sections here, so I'll start with hardware and software and how programs are executed and that sort of thing. And I'm not going to go into extreme technical detail here. I'm going to, as usual, use a lot of analogies and metaphors to make things clear. So basically, what I probably should do, just to make sure everybody's on the same page, is reiterate and kind of restate what hardware and what software is to start with. So first off, software and hardware. Well, the way I like to explain it, it's a pretty easy thing to understand when you think about it this way, is hardware, first off, is all the physical parts of the computer. So anything you can touch, like a mouse, a keyboard, the computer screen, the CPU, the central processing unit inside of the computer, the hard drive inside of the computer, and so forth. Those are all physical parts, and those, therefore, are all hardware. Now, software, on the other hand, is more of the intangible things. These are, well, there's many, many, many individual examples, but they would be, some of the main examples would include the operating system, like Windows XP, Windows Vista, Windows 7. Those are all three versions of the Microsoft Windows operating system. Or on the Mac side, Apple's Mac OS X. So that could be Mac OS 10.4, Tiger, OS 10.5, Leopard, OS 10.6, Snow Leopard. Those are three different versions of that operating system. And the operating system is an example of software. Another example would be, another number of examples would be programs. Those are the programs that you run on your computer. Could be Microsoft Word, it could be your email program, it could be a photo viewing program, it could be iTunes to play music or any of those things. Those are all programs. Programs are another example of software, and they're something that are also known as an application. They perform a specific purpose or function, or maybe a group of related purposes or functions. They let you do something. It's kind of like a tool. You use a tool to achieve a certain purpose. A hammer can be used to drive a nail or pull a nail out of a board and so forth. Or it can be used for a larger task, as part of a larger task like building a house. And so that's an application or program. Again, it's a piece of software. Another few examples would be any kind of document. These are all types of software as well. A Word document, a word processing document in the more general sense, that's an example of software. Any music, like the audio you're listening to right now, it's a piece of software. It's a document is a piece of software. The audio file is a piece of software. A photograph is a piece of software, and so forth. It's an example of software. So basically, the way to think about hardware versus software in terms of an analogy or a metaphor to relate it to something, is you can think of the hardware as physical, like your brain. Okay, that's your brain is physically there in your head, and it does a lot of the work of thinking and everything. But then you have the thoughts themselves, and the thoughts themselves, whether they're memories or something you're imagining or interpreting what I'm saying here right now, all these thoughts are like software. They're not tangible, but they're there, and they sort of run on the hardware of the brain. Okay, so to get to Soren's question, let's see, just pull that back up here. Basically, a program is like an application or a program. These, like I said, it's like a tool, and it performs a certain purpose. But basically, if you look sort of under the hood, so to speak, what a program does and how it works is it's a lot of very, very, very detailed instructions to the computer. And so when someone programs the computer, when they're creating software, that's what programming means, by the way. A lot of people use the word programming to mean making a setting change on the computer or installing something. Programming is actually the creation of software. So if you think of it, software as like a program is like a tool. It's like making that hammer rather than using the hammer. Using the hammer is not programming. Making the hammer is programming, so to speak. So using a program is not programming, but making a program is programming. And when you program, when someone programs, creates a program or programs an application, they're working with code. Now the code, of course, is just the set of instructions. Now it's not something that most people, if they looked at the code, what they call the source code of the program, for most people it would look like a whole bunch of gibberish. I'm not a programmer per se, because that's a specialized field, and I do have some background in programming, and so I can look at a program's code and I can kind of say, okay, I think this does this, this does that, but I can't really make a program from scratch. I could learn that to do that if I wanted to, but it's just not something that's ever been a real priority for me. Beyond the basic intro core level programming courses that I took years and years ago. But basically, the program is just a series of very detailed instructions. Now, if you think about a set of instructions, when we talk to each other and we say, you know, for example, we give directions to somebody to drive into town and go to the bookstore, you would probably tell them something like, drive down the main, you know, Highway 11 or whatever, take a right on Henry Street, and it's the first driveway on your right, pull in there. And that's all the instructions that a person needs. Now, admittedly, someone who's very new to driving or who doesn't know the area very well might need some slightly more detailed instructions than that, but it's never going to be down to the point of where, for example, you might imagine if you wanted really insanely detailed instructions such as lift your right arm, now lift your left arm, now rotate your hands and close your fingers around the steering wheel. That's that round thing in the middle in front of you, da-da-da-da-da, and so forth. You can imagine that no one's ever going to want that much detailed instructions because we can figure this stuff out and we don't need to be told that to use the steering wheel, you rotate your hands and blah, 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 blah. And certainly, we don't have any way, I mean, the things that happen that would allow us to actually move our hands and close our fingers around the steering wheel and that sort of thing, that happens at such a deep level in our unconscious mind that you really couldn't give directions that detailed. But computers, on the other hand, they're kind of dumb. That's one way of thinking about it. They need the most insanely detailed instructions beyond what you could ever believe were possible. Down to the point where if, for example, a computer was moving a person's body, or let's say it's a robot or something like that, and you're creating a program that makes the robot walk and get into the car and drive the car or what have you. Let's say it's a humanoid robot that looks and moves more or less like a human being does. Well, to be able to accomplish that, you would actually have to create at some point software that instructs the robot on how to move its muscles, or whatever works as a muscle for a robot, and to move its fingers and do all the stuff that we just do. We just think about doing things, we do it. Now, once you program it, you can have these things that hold all those sort of common behaviors and common instructions, and they're basically can get loaded into a new program. So you don't have to work from scratch each time, but it really is actually, it's pretty much that much detail has to be taught to the computer for it to actually function and do things. For example, when you open up Microsoft Word, you double click an icon, but the computer at some point needed to be instructed. And this is something, it starts off at a level where it starts off with the operating system understanding what on earth to do when you move that mouse around, or what on earth to do when you double click that mouse button, and what to do when you double click it in one place versus another place, like on the desktop on an empty spot versus on the Word icon, and so forth. And so it's just that set of instructions, that's what programming is essentially. And then once you've created that, you have to compile it into what's called an executable file. An executable file is just, it's just a program like Word or iTunes or Picasa or more or less any program you've ever heard of. Well, in fact, every program you've ever heard of, those are executable files. It just means a program that has all that code and all those incredibly detailed instructions all sort of compiled, as they say, or put together into a file, into a format that can be run by your computer. And you don't need to have special software to run it. It just runs because it can talk to the operating system, and it's able to go from the operating system then on to the hardware and so forth. So basically, when you run a program, it's almost like you're going to a set of shelves that you have tools on, and you're picking the tool that you need to do whatever it is you're trying to do. A set of shelves, of course, is a hard drive. Then once you've picked those things up, you would walk over to your workbench, and you start working on your project there on the workbench. And the workbench, of course, is like the computer's memory or RAM. That's the temporary working space that it needs to accomplish projects or tasks. Now, when software is running, it needs to be able to talk to the hardware in one way or another. It may need to draw a picture on the screen, like buttons, for example, and the window that the button is located in, and the text, the words that appear on that window, and so forth. That needs to be able to talk to the video card inside of the computer. That's what sends the picture to the screen. And that video card needs to be able to send that picture. And it needs to understand what information is being sent to it to pass on to the screen. It may also, if it's maybe something like iTunes that plays music, that might need to be able to access the sound card in the computer. That's another piece of hardware. And that's what is hooked up to the computer speakers and relays the sound, like my voice in this case, to the computer speakers. Now, to accomplish this, it needs to go through the operating system. That's Windows or Mac OS X or what have you. And then the operating system uses something called a driver to communicate with the hardware. And it all goes sort of through the operating system, which handles all the drivers. Generally speaking, the programs themselves don't have direct access to the hardware. That usually goes through the operating system. And the driver, of course, as I've explained elsewhere, a driver is essentially an interpreter. Think of someone who comes from a foreign country and they don't speak the local language, maybe they're a diplomat, and so they have an interpreter who takes what they say and translates it into the local tongue. And that's essentially what a driver does. It allows the hardware, two pieces of hardware to communicate with each other, or some piece of software to communicate with the hardware. Because each piece of equipment essentially speaks a different language, and so you need to have the right driver or interpreter to communicate with it. Now, a lot of that stuff is pretty technical, and I didn't want to go into too much detail because it's beyond what most people are interested in learning about. But it's a basic kind of an overview with a few analogies and metaphors, and hopefully that all made sense. Now, there is another section to Soren's question, and I'm going to go and answer that separately in the next track.